not think it, but the 60s and 70s were a hotbed of innovation in electric car design. Environmental and political events collided that got people questioning our reliance on the internal combustion engine and thinking about alternatives. So why was so much effort put into electric cars when so few people bought them? And how close did we come to perfecting hybrid and EV technology? Let's find out. There have been electric cars almost as long as there have been cars. They didn't need the potentially arm-breaking starter handle, and they were a quiet and pleasant way to get from A to B. Soon they were outpacing the internal combustion engine, breaking the land speed record in 1898 and becoming the first car to an earth-shattering 60 miles an hour. But the cheap price of petrol and additional range consigned the electric car to the scrap heap. First off is the Henny Kilowatt, released way back in 1959. Although an American car, it used many body parts from the very French Renault Dauphine. The project was funded by the National Union Electric Company that also produced Exide batteries and was keen to find new ways to use them. With tweaks, the 1960 model had a top speed of around 60 miles an hour and a range of over 60 miles. Although 100 cars were built, or semi-built, only 47 were ever sold, many of them to electric utility companies. One of the first electric cars of the modern age came out of an unlikely place, Detroit in 1966. But the rationale of the Electrovair 2 wasn't saving money on petrol, not when it seemed cheaper than water in the USA in the 60s. This was to help with air pollution, which was becoming a hot issue, particularly in Los Angeles. Clean air legislation provided funding to car companies to invest in electric car technology, and the big car companies were happy to use it. The Electrovair 2 would use the Corvair as a starting point. It was GM's lightest vehicle, and the rear-mounted engine could be removed and easily swapped for a motor to power the rear wheels. Best of all, GM had a ton of them on hand after Ralph Nader killed sales by exposing the car as essentially a death trap. The Electrovair 2 was strictly a concept based on, you guessed it, the Electrovair 1. It would use silver zinc batteries, a byproduct of military spending. They were 3 times lighter than lead acid batteries and much smaller. But even with those light batteries, it was still heavier than the petrol Corvair. And those special silver zinc batteries were expensive and would only last 100 charges. Acceleration was similar to its petrol engine sibling. It would get to 80 miles an hour and had an 80 mile range if driven carefully and would take 6 hours to recharge. But those batteries still took up a lot of room, completely taking over the front boot, leaving no space for luggage. But GM wasn't naive. They realized this wasn't something that could be taken into production and that they had to wait for better battery technology. With a downturn in aircraft orders, the Scottish Aviation Company released its take on the electric car in 1966 as the Scamp. With the government worried that a rapid growth in car ownership would result in congestion and pollution, and backing from the Electricity Board, they created a tiny microcar with a fiberglass body and 4 48-volt batteries. But its roadworthiness test was a disaster, with delicate suspension that would collapse at any moment, and a boot door that opened during the test, and the spare wheel fell out. Barely discouraged, they got none other than Stirling Moss to demonstrate it, but with a top speed of 36 miles an hour and an 18 mile range, and a projected high cost to purchase, it wasn't going to turn heads. AMC were also thinking of reducing air pollution with their Amitron in 1967. They also realized that lead-acid batteries were far too heavy, so their concept would use nickel-cadmium and lithium batteries, bringing the weight from 907 kilograms with lead-acid batteries to just 91 kilograms. The NiCad batteries would be used for acceleration, with the lithium batteries used for sustained speeds. And the Amitron was one of the first cars to have regenerative braking. The combination of innovative batteries and regenerative braking gave the Amitron a range of 150 miles that's still impressive today. AMC wanted to put the car into production, but the expense of the cutting-edge batteries made that impossible. Looking like a tiny Nissan Cube, Ford UK produced the diminutive commuter prototype. At half the length of the Ford Cortina, it was still able to shoehorn four people inside. It had a 37-mile range and a speed of 25 miles an hour, but like all lead-acid battery cars, it suffered from awful acceleration. But there was interest across all car companies in 1967, with BMC charging Mini creator Alec Isogonis to dream up an electric car of its own. The same year, the UK Electric Vehicle Association put out a press release. They were proud to announce that the UK had more electric vehicles running on UK roads than any other country. What they didn't make clear was most of them were this. The humble electric milk float has been around since at least the 1930s, and by the 1950s had completely replaced horse-drawn milk floats. Electric vehicles suited milk delivery. Most routes were fairly short, which allowed cheap lead-acid batteries to be used, and they could be recharged every day back at the base. They were quiet, useful at a time when people didn't expect engine noise early in the morning. A high top speed isn't important when you're carrying delicate milk bottles around, but that didn't stop a souped-up Weetabix-sponsored milk float setting a world speed record of 84 miles an hour. Milk floats are getting rarer as more people get their milk from supermarkets. Ironically, in a day when more electric cars are taken to the road, those remaining milk floats are switching to petrol or diesel power to speed up deliveries. General Motors released their new electric vision in 1969. They were keen to show off their research team's abilities to create cars that ran on electricity, steam, or even nuclear power. But it was these four prototypes, created a few years earlier, that got the headlines. The yellow car used a small petrol engine, as did the Sinclair C5-like low-slung silver three-wheeler, somehow pitched as a commuter car. But the red and blue cars were more interesting. The red car was all electric with a 58-mile range. The blue car was a hybrid, using both petrol engine and electric power. It would power the car to 10 miles an hour on electricity, shifting to use the petrol engine at higher speeds. But like a latter-day hybrid, it would charge the batteries while the petrol engine was running or idling. GM would recycle it as the larger XP883 concept car around the same time. These cars weren't intended to be driven on regular roads. At a time when most American cars were the size and shape of a football pitch, these tiny cars would have been a death trap. GM envisioned that they would be driven on their own specially created highways. As an idea, that's sort of a non-starter. GM was testing the waters with new markets and was watching the increase in popularity of electric golf carts that wouldn't just be used on the golf range, but in neighbourhoods built near them. Golf carts had been around since the 1930s for disabled golfers, but had been gaining popularity for lazy golfers since the 1950s. They've been modified to become general-purpose neighbourhood electric vehicles, and today are used in locations like airports to transport people with difficulties walking, or by the police to move around in urban areas. Also thinking about North American air pollution, BMW created the 1602E concept. It had a range of 38 miles, a top speed of 62 miles an hour, and it used an early form of regenerative braking. With Munich holding the Olympic Games in 1972, BMW publicly displayed the car and used it to support the long distance races such as the marathon. Probably the most famous electric car of the 70s is not what you would think of when you thought of an electric car. In 1971, NASA blasted a Saturn V to the moon, and neatly folded on the lunar lander was the all-electric LRV, or Lunar Roving Vehicle. Two more were sent to the moon where they covered an impressive 56 miles. Power came from two 36-volt silver-zinc potassium hydroxide batteries. Needless to say, they weren't rechargeable. Each rover had a theoretical range of 57 miles in the low lunar gravity. The focus in the 60s had been around using electricity to reduce air pollution, but with the 1973 oil crisis, electric cars were pitched as a way to cut our reliance on petrol. Middle East oil nations stopped exporting to many Western countries for their perceived support for Israel in the Yom Kippur War. Over a few months, this quadrupled the price of petrol, and there were times you couldn't even get it at all. Enfield Automotive had tested the waters in 1969 with the Enfield 465 prototype, but they must have thought their timing was perfect when they released the Enfield 8000 in 1973. The tiny car had a 55-mile range if you were going downhill, and the top speed of a whopping 48 miles an hour. But it was tiny. With a wheelbase 8 inches shorter than a Mini, it looked like a Reliant kitten that had been left too long in the dryer. But that tiny size would make it a perfect city car. It was built on the Greek island of Syros, as its backer was a Greek millionaire. There were high hopes that this would be the start of something big, and a Jeep style was produced for the car rental market on the Greek islands. They expected charging subsidies from the electric board would make running it cheaper, but with it costing the same price as a 3-litre Ford Capri and being double the price of a Mini, only 120 were ever made between 1973 and 1976. But one of those 120 was transformed into something truly special. Johnny Smith threw out the old lead-acid batteries and replaced it with more modern technology to make it the fastest electric car on four wheels. With an estimated top speed of 140 miles an hour, it could get to 60 miles an hour in under 3 seconds. The Italian coach builder Zagato had their own take on an electric car in 1974. They were famous for the Alfa Romeo Giulietta TZ and the Junior Z. So with their design knowledge of sleek Italian cars, they designed this boxy thing. It's a shape so simple, it looked like someone designed it using Lego. The Zelle ran on good old lead-acid batteries, giving it a range of 50 miles. The Zelle had a Spartan interior, with a complicated 4-position speed selector and a 2-position foot pedal that could be used to select 6 forward speeds and 2 reverse speeds. The Zelle 2000 was fitted with a larger 2000 watt motor that featured a boost switch which, once at top speed, weakens the motor's magnetic fields in the field coils to produce less torque, but a greater top speed of 30 miles an hour. Despite selling it in the USA as the Zagato L car, only 500 were made and production ended in 1976. The same year, something of a car-sharing revolution was happening in the Netherlands. Some Amsterdam residents wanted to reduce traffic, so hit upon the idea of a car-sharing scheme, years before Zipcar. They named their scheme Witcar, or White Car in English, and used a fleet of 35 white and orange cars. The whole scheme was controlled by a PDP-11 minicomputer. The scheme failed because of the car's long recharging times, meaning few were available when needed, and the cars were rarely where you wanted them as traffic tended to all flow in the same direction, a problem London's Boris bikes have, requiring large vans to move the bikes around during the day. Back in the USA and hoping to cash in on the oil crisis was CityCar. Released in 1974, it features a simple triangular shape that was generously referred to as a coupe, or coupe if you like. With a top speed of 38 miles an hour and a range of 40 miles, the city car was certainly confined to city use. The company was sold in 1977, and the car renamed as the commuter car until 1982. It was produced in Sebring, Florida, and sold 4,444 cars. Later in its life, comically large bumpers were added to comply with US safety laws, although it's unlikely the city car would do enough damage to other cars or pedestrians to warrant their inclusion. The commuter van was also introduced for the US Postal Service as a delivery van. American Motors' take on the electric vehicle was the 1974 Electruck, based on the Jeep DJ. It used 2 27-volt lead-acid batteries and had a 33-mile-an-hour top speed with a 29-mile range. 352 were also sold to the US Postal Service as delivery vans as a way to help reduce city pollution. With oil crisis fever gripping the world, a desire for independence from the wills of Middle East countries, and oil prices expected to go higher and higher, the large American car companies produced new concepts to test the waters with customers. First out of the gates was GM, with their third electric vehicle concept in 10 years, the Electrovette. GM removed the engine from a Chevrolet Chevette and fitted good old lead-acid batteries. The top speed was 55 miles an hour with a range of 50 miles. GM had hopes of putting it into production in the 80s, with 10% of cars being electric by the 1990s. AMC tried again with a 1977 Electron. If you thought it was the same as the Amitron from 1967, you'd be right. Although AMC hadn't spent the past 10 years just sitting on their hands. The updated Electron had side mirrors and a new exterior colour, because nothing says 1970s more than orange paint. But NiCad and lithium batteries hadn't got any cheaper, and it fared about as well as the original Amitron concept. At the end of the 70s, Garrett, the turbocharger company, was sponsored by the newly created Department of Energy to produce an experimental car. It used a regular array of lead-acid batteries, but used a novel concept of a flywheel to store energy when braking. A concept later championed and productized by the Williams Formula One team for applications like London buses. But those lead-acid batteries would still need replacing after only a few years. Over at Chrysler, again with the Department of Energy's help, they were pitching the remarkably similar looking ETV1 with the help of General Electric. It would feature regenerative braking, a top speed of 65 miles an hour and a 100 mile range. It would also use a novel T-shaped battery pack that was easily replaceable, the same concept tried by Tesla over 30 years later. With the heavy weight of lead-acid batteries, electric car acceleration was severely hampered, and with the space they took up, the cars just weren't practical. The 80s and 90s brought more EV developments, but the key ingredients to make a successful hybrid and EV were there by the late 70s. Regenerative braking, hybrid engines, and lithium batteries. Toyota would put them into a winning hybrid package in the late 90s, but it would take cheaper, lighter, smaller lithium-ion batteries in the next century to make fully electric vehicles a practical alternative. It takes a lot of time and effort to make these videos. To get early access to new videos or appear in the credits, please consider supporting me using the Patreon link below from just $1 or 80p a month, and hit that subscribe button to get notified of new videos. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next video.